So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please give him a warm round of applause. Brad Shorkend. Just leave me hanging, sister. It's cool. It's cool, cool, cool.
It's okay.
You got jokes, huh?
Well, someone has to. Okay, you're going to... I know there's some camera settings that need to happen. Is everything as it needs? Are you good? Ah, fantastic. You know, it was really interesting. I was standing at the back there and I was watching as Francois made the comment about they're looking at your social media profiles when they're about to look at are you employment worthy? You know, the same applies for are you date worthy? And I saw a whole lot of people straight away go to Facebook and there was just deleting going on like crazy and rewriting and... We're going to get to that just now about what happens in that process. But also, just to nudge and get a little bit of participation here, who likes to read? Who likes to read books that were signed by the author? Ooh. Oh, yeah. So I had this left over. I was at a client earlier today. They bought one extra. I brought it here. It's going to go to somebody who has the best question, or let's see how the evening unfolds. And this is a conversation. So now... If you were to type into a browser, take Google for example, and you type in this little prompt, my job makes me, what do you think? If you go to Google, what do you think people type in? Because remember, the search engine gives you the most searched prompts, tells you what other people are searching for. What do you think people are saying their job makes them? Happy, I heard a happy. Okay, no, that was... Hey. Thank goodness there's some of that going on. But if you do the exercise for yourself, I'll give you the results of the exercise. Miserable. Depressed and anxious. My job makes me cry. There's a whole lot of that going on. My job makes me sick to my stomach. My job makes me suicidal. Feel worthless. You can do the exercise. My job makes me angry. My job makes me unhappy. My job makes me drink. Now... Which is fantastic if you work for breweries. You work for breweries, good times. I was in London a few weeks ago, and I was at Twining's Tea, they're clients of mine, and I shared this with them, and they were like, why are people not drinking more tea because of their stress? It's calming. There's chamomile. And like, no. So they're considering a diversification. What if it was to look like this? What if my job makes me look like this? Is this not what we're moving towards or should be moving towards? But we're all responsible for this. In some way, means or form, we're part of this gig. What about my boss makes me? What do you think this reveals? Ooh. How many bosses in the room? How many people have people reporting into them? How many of you are not owning up to the fact that you have people reporting into you? How many of you work and have influence over bosses? Okay, all right, it's a sad tale. Nervous, feel stupid, anxious, feel worthless. My boss makes me cry. This is a true story, it's all there for you in Google. So this left me with this, I mean, I've always been obsessed with understanding the human experience and what goes on in the world of work. I was an architect and I ran my practice for about 16 years and we had to understand people. Because you can't design space if you don't understand people. I never realized that this would become a career and I would become a behavioral specialist, and now almost 20 years of doing this. You know the difference is? The difference is at 16 years of building an architecture practice, I felt like I was done. At almost 20 years, I know you're trying to do the maths, I'm in my 50s, at almost 20 years of doing this, I feel like I'm just warming up. What is the future? What is the future? And it's a whole lot of stuff that's been coming at us at a rate of knots. I mean, I could fill this whole page with stuff that most of us don't understand or we're trying to get a grasp on. But the real conversation, the real WTF is actually, what are they feeling? What are they, that one. Yeah, what are they feeling? Because this is about people. And regardless of technology or the speed of innovation, people are still people. And the rules of humanity still apply. That has not changed. No matter what goes on, no matter whether we have lockdowns or technological advances or wars on the other side of the world, people are still people. And there are laws around humanity. Whether we like them or not, they exist. Simon Sinek, very powerful thought leader. He's the start with why guy, Golden Circle. Most of you all know Simon Sinek. I saw him in a podcast recently, and he said 100% of employees are people. 100% of customers are people. And 100% of investors are people. Think about it. His maths is solid. Solid. And if you don't understand people, you don't understand business. If you don't understand people, you don't understand business. Let that sink in. But, and I think it's profound, I think it's brilliant, but I think there's more to it. I think if you don't care about people, you don't care about business. Because if you really understand deeply, or understand that business happens because of people, for people, with people. Now, when you let that sink in, this becomes a different conversation. This becomes a conversation about ROI. What is ROI? Return on investment. Okay, so we've got some financial minds in the room. But if it's about ROI and it's about a return on investment, because every human being is an investment. It costs to have people in your business. It costs money. They are an investment. Are you optimizing that investment? Are you doing the right things with that investment? Is that investment bringing you the return it needs to? And if it doesn't, what do you do with it? Do you make smarter decisions around it? I came across this recently, and I thought, I see leaders say this. You're not paid to think. A mindless worker is a happy worker. Shut up and do your job. How many of you have experienced leaders who have this kind of vibe going on? They're not in the room, unless they are in the room. I see this every single day. I work with businesses all over the world, and I see this going on. You don't need to think. Just do what you need to do. Don't need your thinking. But now, are we really optimizing the investment? Or is the ROI that we are playing with the risk of ignorance? Is it the risk of ignorance? A few years ago, I took a lifetime of experience and learning and failure and success and decided for the fifth time to try and write a book. First four just didn't work. I wasn't writing the right thing. And this is the book that was produced. It's called We Are Still Human and Work Shouldn't Suck. And I was looking for content, and I came across a beautiful quote from Pascal Finet. At that stage, he was a faculty member at Singularity University, and he said that humans are not a resource. They are the source. They are the source of everything that a company does. The source of everything that a company does. And I tracked him down and found him. He lives in the US, he's from Germany originally. We had a long conversation around this. And I realized that the book I wanted to put together was about treating this human source the way it deserved to be treated. The book hit the shelves in December of 2018. And if you have a look at what's in that little circle, that was what is on the front cover. How to build relevant businesses and exceptional work experiences for human beings in a world that has gone digital crazy. 2018, December. 1 year later, the world went properly digital mad. COVID happened. Somebody was nibbling on a bat in Wuhan, and that was what went down. And our book went, and I say our because I co-authored it with my then business partner. And what was amazing was how suddenly this human narrative was just amplified. It's like we had written the Bible for how to deal with COVID in a lot of ways. But that wasn't the real point. For me, what became really interesting was this conversation about switching human beings on. And we started to ask the question, and this is a question I'm posing to every single one of you. You've got to be honest with yourselves. This is no time for head in the sand stuff. Are the people you lead and or work with? I'm very deliberate about that question. Because everyone always pushes it to the leaders, or pushes it to HR. That's the best one. Leaders make everything that they're not comfortable with an HR thing. It's not an HR thing. It's called bad leadership when you go, no, it belongs at HR. That's called bad leadership for me. Are the people you lead and or work with, your colleagues, being switched on and grown, or sorry, switched off and depleted, shut down, demotivated, uninspired, not wanting to give of their discretionary efforts? Or are they being switched on and grown, motivated, invited to participate? They feel safe. They feel comfortable. They want to give of their best. They're being invited to think. They're being made smarter. Are being challenged. Now, this is not a static dynamic. This is a moving thing. At any given time, we could be moving in the direction of switching people off and depleting them, or moving in the direction of switching people on and growing them. The question you've got to be asking yourself is, in which direction are you moving more frequently, and with what intensity? With what intensity? When you are in that direction of switching someone off, the thing you're causing for them, the experience you're causing, what's going on in that moment? And what we found when we were doing our research is that there were certain types of companies that are obsessed about getting the switched on thing right. We spoke to hundreds of organizations all over the world, and we coined the phrase a CBA, a company behaving awesomely. And Francois, you spoke to some of this, attracting, retaining, growing. That's the definition. A company behaving awesomely is an organization to which the best people want to come, choose to come. They do come, they choose to stay at. And while they're working there, they shoot the lights out. While they're working there, they shoot the lights out. And the result of that would then be exceptional business outputs and kick-ass innovation. Business outputs and kick-ass innovation, and people are proud to say they work there. That's a winning combination, and that is a CBA, or a company behaving awesomely. Now, how close is your organization, your team environment, to being a CBA? Are you attracting? Do people want to come because they hear it's an amazing place to be? Do they choose to stay because they're being grown, they're having an amazing time? You've got to start to get real with these questions. So what we did is we said, okay, let's understand these organizations. What is it that makes them work the way they work? And we were looking for five. We were observing, interviewing, visiting, traveling. We're looking for five key experience touch points, the things that they obsess about getting right. Five became seven, seven became 12, because we just couldn't ignore the stuff we were finding. And we built this model, and I'll explain to you the moving parts of it. And we went back to them. We said, hold on, we found 12. It feels cumbersome and clunky. What can we take out? And every single person around the world said, you can't take any of those out. Those 12 human experience touch points are the things we invest in, we obsess about getting right. Because if any of those slip or dip, we have dire consequences, and we've seen it. So we went a step further, and we studied the impact of this on trust. And what we found was organizations that consistently maintain a high level of experience for all of these, or as many of them as possible at any given time, build what we call the container of trust, where people feel safe to experiment, feel like people have their backs. And then, when you get that right, you have the company behaving awesomely. It is a container. Container of trust, company behaving awesomely. So, if you really understand how it works, then what happens is you say, well, okay, how do we do that? And we went a step further and we Englishified each of those essentials. Englishified meaning you can actually understand what they mean. Because what kills me is I see culture documents and culture handbooks and employee handbooks, and it's all this rubbish jargon that no one knows what to do with it. I don't know how to work with it. I don't know how to lead with it. It's just a fancy thing that an agency costs you, charge you a few million rand for. Sorry, publishing people and agencies, but do it properly. Make it land. So we went a step further, made it tangible in English, and then started to apply it into business. What happens when you start to look at each of these essentials? Take gas. Now I'm asking you to think about your own world. Gas, giving a shit. We care about our company and our colleagues, and our company and our colleagues care about us. Who's got any ideas? As you look at this model, which of the essentials would be most negatively impacted if the gas is low? What other experience touch points are gonna go down? What do you think? Everything. Everything's gonna go down, yeah? Anything specific, because you're right. What would most be affected if the gas is low? What about stoke? Constantly creating wow moments for everyone, intern and extern, that brings them back for more. If you're not experienced, when somebody just doesn't give a shit, they're not creating wow moments. They just don't care. And you could keep going around the model. What about if we have a look at meaningful communication? Our messaging is succinct, specific, relevant, authentic. We're available to receive, we're listening. What happens when meaningful communication is not being emphasized, invested in, maintained as a high level experience? What else is gonna go down? Shared purpose for sure. Knowledge flow, innovation with intent. You see where I'm going with this? And so we go. So, this is going on all the time. When you start to understand that experience is not isolated, there are lots of touch points that are consistently creating the way people are being made to feel and how they can participate and show up. Start to realize we've got a lot of work to do. What organizations do, however, is they invest in one thing. They'll take millions and they'll go and they'll do a fancy workspace. We've got green couches and foosball. It's a cool culture. No, you have things you're going to be selling when you close down. Or things people want in their lounges. Or they go and develop massively in people development. People push. Develop big money, which I love because they spend it on us. But I try and get them to spend it in a way that's going to make a difference. But you can't ignore the others. I say, but you've got to get the whole culture right. You can't just hope for a holy grail leadership program. It doesn't work. So, when you come back and you start to understand how each of these work, and I'm happy to share this information. It's in the book. It's online. And you start to analyze your own business or the team you work in or the business environment. Start to understand the experience. And you start to score it. You start to see why you have so many of the problems, the people puzzles that you have, because people are being switched off, people are being depleted. So you've got to ask yourself as well, are you making assumptions? Might you be guilty of misguided opinion, of assumption? I've highlighted over there awakenedness. It's one of the key essentials, especially now during COVID. We are always switched on, tuned in, and adjusting to suit. Switched on, tuned in, and adjusting to suit. Empathy-based innovation. Are you assuming? Are you functioning on opinion? Whoops. Might you be guilty? Do we need to start to get real? We need to start to really observe. You need to become intentional around real observation. How many of you are really paying attention to what's going on around you? Or you know things are going on, but you don't know why? I learned something new the other day. Anyone here know what a Jemba walk is? Anyone know what a Jemba walk is? So cool when you're the speaker and you're the smarty pants in the room. A Jemba walk is Japanese and it means the actual place. What a Gemba. Okay, smarter than me. Gemba walk. And it comes from lean practice and whatnot. From? Kaizen. Okay. Okay. Anyone? Anyone who wants to know more about a Gemba walk, please go and talk to Deirdre. But what it is in a nutshell is I learned about it. A client of mine said, come, we're going for a walk. And we went for a walk through the facility because he said, I cannot run my business from upstairs. I need to see what's going on in the rest of the building. And this followed. He saw the video. I don't know if you saw Mark's promo video of me being filmed up there, about the story I told of the guy who came into the CEO's office, and the CEO, he complained, and the CEO said to him, sit in my chair. Now, you are the CEO. What would you do to solve the problem? And the guy said, hold on a second, which I thought was good leadership. He said, come for a walk with me. He said, now, you have my job. What are you going to do about my problem? Which was brilliant. And this guy saw that, and he said, we are going to do Gemba walks. So we've got to get to where things are going on. We need to connect more to really understand. You can't possibly try and make decisions at a distance. Hootsuite, another great story. 2017, CEO happened to find himself by accident in the mailroom where they do posts and whatnot. And there was a package going out and he looked at all the steps and the processes. They were sending a t-shirt as a gift to a client for something that had gone on. And he did a little exercise and he worked out that a $15 t-shirt, by the time it gets to where it has to go to, costs them $200. They were sending hundreds of t-shirts out, losing a fortune. And because of all of the nonsense that had just crept in terms of steps and processes, and he employed somebody in a full-time role as the czar of bad processes. This person's job, is to fine tooth comb and nitpick everything and look for cash. Look for opportunity, look for wastage, look for inefficiencies. Do you know how this person is paid? Percentage of savings. How's that for motivation? Do you know how much this person earns? Millions of dollars. Millions of dollars. Now, how many of you need to be fine-tooth combing the systems and the processes, getting yourself a czar of bad processes. Millions. It changes the game. I've been through this process myself recently. I had to relook my business. Lots has changed. We used to front our business with a massive employee experience assessment. A couple of hundred questions. It would take us 3 months of interviewing and whatnot. We'd earn a lot of money for it. But I noticed that my client connection was dropping because of how long it was taking. And I decided to do something very different. I've just literally today launched a fresh website. And I've now made this 16 questions. It was over 100 questions. It's 16 questions on the website for free. My back pocket of my wallet is going, have you lost your mind? Because we used to charge fortunes for thousands of people to go through these assessments. But I wasn't doing the client justice because it was taking too long. I'm now rather saying, you know what, answer 16 questions. You'll get a sense of just where things are at, and then let's start doing the work. Let's get stuck in a week's time, let's get stuck straight in. I'm taking a risk. Because it takes 10 minutes, not even 10, it takes 5 minutes to answer these questions. But I believe that I was switched on, tuned in, and I've adjusted to suit. But I had to take a deep breath and get comfortable with that. I had to go back in here and have a look at what are all the points of connect, what's breaking down, what's up, and what do I change? I'm inviting you to do the same thing because there are no neutral moments. Every single moment that you're creating for another human being, whether as a leader, whether as an HR practitioner, because I know there are lots of HR professionals here, every single moment matters. Even if you're just a colleague, not just, working with other people. Every moment, there are no neutral moments. You're either switching someone on and growing them, or switching them off and depleting them. Every single moment. So we need to learn to think in moments. Got to learn to think in moments. So, I'm sharing 5 principles with you this evening. First one, employee experience matters a lot. Cannot deny the significance of the experience every single human being in your environment is having. It matters. It needs intentionality. It needs investment. Do not take your eye off it. Do not take your eye off it. How much are you making it matter?
I'll tell you what's happening.
What's happening?
No, you're fine.
Thank you for that.
It's crapping against your shirt.
Okay.
And we're editing me out.
But what did you just do? Oh, okay. All right. I suppose I have to have this for the filming. Okay. Because I can, even with my, hit the back. Okay. All right, so how much are you making it matter? That is a very in-your-face provocation. How much are you making it matter? Whatever your context is, how much are you making it matter? I mean really making it matter. How much are you really making it matter? The greatest enemy of knowledge is not ignorance, but the illusion of knowledge. The greatest enemy of knowledge is not ignorance, but the illusion of knowledge. And I like to introduce this early in any workshop I do, any talk I do, because it usually sets the tone for what happens afterwards. I was at a conference, innovation conference. This is shortly, probably a year or so before COVID. And there was a gentleman there by the name of Ralph. And having a conversation with him at lunch. And Ralph, remember I said innovation conference. And Ralph says, we can't be disrupted. It's a tech company. We're rock solid. We're adaptive. We're cool. They no longer exist, by the way. But I was so taken aback that I decided to do the mature thing and meme Ralph. And so Ralph stands for refusing to allow learning and progress to happen. R-A-L-P-H. The reason I said that this usually sets the tone for the rest of the conversation is because we are all Ralph. Is anyone's name Ralph in the ID book, by the way? I mean no offense. But we all are Ralph at some point in time without even realizing it. Quite unintentionally. In fact, quite well-intentionally often. We just don't realize the impact of our behaviors. Now, what I'm inviting you to do is pause for a second and think about what are some of the ways in which you may be getting in the way of learning and progress. Just take 15 seconds, think about what are some or even one way that you might be getting in the way of learning and progress. Any brave volunteers? Who wants to share? How are you getting in the way of learning and progress? What if it's not you? Oh, you mean that blaming other people doesn't get in the way of learning and progress? And I completely acknowledge what you said. It's a very common feedback. Is like when I do leadership training, often, almost always, they say, have you done this with our bosses? And they're right, because often the bad behavior is upstairs. In fact, more bad behavior happens with senior leadership. I call them the walk on waters, who kind of get away with murder. And then the youngsters, the new people in the business, look up and go, oh, so that's how you become successful. That's how you become successful. So you're right. But I want to challenge you as to totally acknowledge your point, and I agree with it. Where might you also be getting in the way of learning and progress? Every single one of us does. Senior management. Who of you are senior management in your businesses? Am I right or am I wrong that you see your colleagues? It's not career limiting. They're not here. We're going to get into the leadership conversation shortly. Here's some examples. Refusing to hear new ideas or suggestions. Right there. Boom. Ralph. Or wanting self-starters. Say, no, people must work it out themselves. Let me just get the job done. No babysitting. You expect somebody to arrive and on day one just be fantastic. Like they've arrived at a party you've been at for years and they must just pick up the tunes and it doesn't work. What about getting angry or screaming and shouting when things aren't done your way? That's Ralphing. Or avoiding holding people accountable, sweeping things under the rug, creating a blame culture, learning in progress, not going to happen. So again, now with a couple of examples under your belts, what are some of the ways in which you are getting in the way of learning and progress? I see a hand. We have a volunteer. Well said. Nobody told you this was a magic act as well. Well said. Brilliant. Closing yourself off to innovation. Closing yourself off to innovation. Absolutely. Trying to just be stuck with, because that's the way we've always done things around here. That is a suicidal mindset. We've got to get into new ways of doing things. Okay. So it is okay to change your mind. It's okay to change your mind. It's your mind after all. You can change your mind. Get comfortable with changing your mind. I really enjoyed this when I saw Thomas Sowell. He was a university professor, economics at Stanford. And he said that intellect is not wisdom. I see too many smarty pantses running around, clever people, thinking that they're the bee's knees. Sorry for those of you who are these. But having no idea how to apply that intellect practically. Google took away your advantage. Everyone who knows stuff, Google took away your advantage, but Google doesn't know how to apply stuff. We now need to get wise. We need to start taking knowledge and information and converting it to application. We need to be curious. We need to be brave. That's where the magic's going to happen. Alvin Toffler, very famous quote, futurist, wrote Future Shock in the 1960s. He said, I'm frustrated with this. I'm seeing everybody running around on the unlearn, relearn bandwagon, and I think it's rubbish. I'll tell you why. He said the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. Think about that. I don't agree, with all due respect to a very smart man, to an intellect. I think that the irrelevant of the 21st century will not be those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. Sorry, Elvin. But those who cannot learn, interpret, and test. Those who cannot learn, interpret, and test. Gather information, work it out, make sense of it, try something. Because unlearning goes against everything that we in this world are about. Unlearning goes against everything we're about now. What does an artificial intelligence do? It doesn't unlearn, it learns. I think we should gather as much information as possible and become better at filtering. Better at filtering. And what I suggested there is not a fixed dynamic. It's learn, interpret, test. Learn, interpret, test. Learn, interpret, test. I think if we get good at this, that's where we will win. That's not Ralph behavior, though. So, principle two, do not be Ralph. Do not be Ralph. And no one said it would be easy. No one said it would be easy. This is hard work. Winning, no one wins by doing no major work. So, I mentioned leadership earlier. One of the biggest questions I got asked, the biggest, that I've been asked over the past 30 months since COVID took hold of the world is, how do we lead? What's the new leadership style? What's the different way of, you know, dealing with people? I've got teams, and they're all over the place, and we're remote, and we're hybrid, and we're... And I pissed most people off who asked me the question, because I said, nothing changed. The way you lead didn't change. Just, if you were bad at it before, it got really hard. You needed to be great at creating connection, creating clarity of expectation, communicating, caring about your people, knowing what's going on without having a heavy hand, light touch engagement, building, motivating, inspiring, teaching. Again, I want to repeat, creating clarity of expectation and certainty. If you were doing all of that before, the shift into a new logistic was easy. But if you were crappy at that before, which means you were probably being overpaid, this got hard. So, we went about evolving with many of our clients around the world, a leadership model that people could make sense of. And this is actually becoming book number two at the moment. And I call it the leadership container. What we did is we put the essentials, those 12 experience touch points, right in the middle of why you lead. Think about it. As a leader, the first thing you should be thinking about is the human beings in your area of responsibility. When you wake up in the morning, not how many dollars, how many production units, yes, you've got to get that stuff right, but that's going to be through people. So right in the middle of your leadership mindset and method is the 12 essentials. Then what we did is we said, okay, what we're learning is that people do need DNA. They need the story, the purpose, the mission, the vision, the values, because that guides the how we do the creative experience. So let's get that DNA in there. I've just been, again, through my own rebuild, so I stopped and thought about one of the things that frustrates me more than anything else is when I arrive at a client and I'm having a conversation with HR, CEO, business owner, and say, so tell me about the values. How do you weave them into the way you do things around you? How do you weave them into your leadership behaviors? How do you use them to measure your human metrics? And then that idiot CEO, sorry if this is you, has to look behind them for where the sign is with the values, or quickly goes onto the website to try and find the values. And I'm like, oh my word, I just add a zero to the price because I know it's going to be pain and suffering. But then when articulating my own, I had to think long and hard about what is my own organizational DNA, because I want to walk my talk. This is just some screen grabs of, this is the values line I'm talking about, of this values-driven behavior modality. Are you checking your own values? And are you behaving according to them? Are you leading according to them? Or is it just lip service? So this is what my business stands for. This is how, and I didn't create values. I created value-driven behaviors. Because I think a value is just weak if it doesn't have behavior attached to it. So what we do is we wrap those behavior touch points, those experience touch points, in the values, in the organizational DNA, in the story. Now think about, in your own business, what you can do here. You now have the model for the 12 experience touch points. So let's say we're focusing on meaningful communication. And one of the values, because it's one of the popular ones, is, give me an option here. You're reading my mind. Integrity. So now, okay, cool, you can have it. It's your value. But now we say we're going to obsess about getting meaningful communication right. What does that look like when we wrap it in the value of integrity? Now you have something to work with. You have a behavioral touch point, an experience touch point. You have a value associated. And then when you take it into different areas of your business, in a negotiation, meaningful communication driven by integrity will look this way. We can talk to that. Now you're in the game. Now you're doing the hard work of creating proper experience, not just fancy posters. And that applies to the rest of the organizational DNA. That is your culture. That narrative coupled with the intention around creating experience. Then we go one step further. You'll see here, tolerate and celebrate. Now that you've got that right, what behaviors do you encourage? What behaviors do you celebrate? Because people do more of what they know is desired. What behaviors do you celebrate in your business? What behaviors are you celebrating in your organization? Are you intentional around saying, do more of that? And this is why. Have you thought about it? Or is it just like random? Don't just go, high five, that was lekker. Because they have no idea what was lekker. Tell them, I love the way you did this. What about the behaviors that you're tolerating? What are you tolerating in your businesses? From senior management, what are you tolerating? Colleagues alongside you, colleagues above you, colleagues below you. What are you tolerating that you need to get rid of? Because the behaviors that you're tolerating are breaking the whole system. If you think about it, if you're trying to build a culture, and culture is a wall, and you're putting the bricks into that wall, and it's growing, it's looking beautiful, and someone, maybe a senior leader, keeps coming along and pulling the blocks out of that wall. The wall's going nowhere. Someone's got to do something about that. Can't accept it. It's also setting the tone for other behavior because it is contagious. So, have you been clear on your non-negotiables? Do you need to revisit and restate them? Have you been clear? Do you need to revisit and restate them? We're talking about leadership here. So, I'm making a bold statement. Excuse me. The bold statement I'm making is that human-centric management practices remain rare. I'm saying that based on my own experience. I work inside many organizations all over the world. Human-centered leadership and management still has not got there. The actual behavior, the practicing of the giving a shit about human beings, of applying empathy, of really understanding where people are at, it's very rare. It's almost never existent. I celebrate. I go outside and do like a little jig for joy. I leave meetings to go and celebrate when I see a moment because it's so rare. And two of the levers that are most critical are measuring the toxic effects of the current management practices, really understanding what the toxicity is that they are creating. And then secondly, holding executives accountable for creating human-centric workplaces. There should be an accountability for that deliverable. And there should be a consequence for not creating human-centric workplaces. Because if you're a leader and you're not doing it, what are you doing? What are you doing if not creating great places for people to be? And then we close out the container. And the closing layer of this container inside which the culture, the experience, the energy, the power lives is you, if you are a leader. And it's you even if you aren't, because you're a contributor no matter what. Your own self, your leadership competency, this is where you've got to dial up those skills on engaging other human beings. I got involved in a conversation the other day about the debate between psychological and soft, psychologically safe and soft. Anyone here want to share? What do you think the difference is between a soft culture and a psychologically safe culture? Nice. So what he said, which was really powerful, in a psychologically safe culture, you kind of encourage people to, you don't encourage them, but you make it safe to make mistakes while learning. You make it okay to experiment because you're trying to improve things. And that's known, and it's demonstrated, and it's maintained. Consistency is key. Soft is the perception that many people have of how we need to create our businesses. It needs to be soft. We need to be nice to people. So it's soft. But a good psychologically safe environment doesn't make it soft, but it makes it safe. And there's a big difference in how you make it safe. And it's through the consistency. It's through consistency of application of skills. It's no longer about soft skills. That's not the narrative. It is now about humans being. We need to be more human. That's where the secret lies, in humans being. And to understand what psychological safety is in a nutshell. But if you, for me, this is the most important thing right now to be understanding. And if you want to know more, I would research Amy Edmondson, Professor Amy Edmondson. I think she's at Stanford. She wrote a book called The Psychologically Safe Organization, I think. And it's exactly how we need to be thinking. But it's the belief that you will not be punished or humiliated for speaking up with ideas, questions, concerns, and mistakes. You can have a voice. You will not get killed if you make a mistake. You will not be shut down if you have an idea. How different does your business become? If people are energized towards this type of behavior, how different does your business become? Because it becomes contagious. Both ways, it becomes contagious. And trust is a product of consistency. Trust is a product of consistency. So the bucket is representative of, you have full trust as a human being. You should have full trust until you start punching holes in the bucket. And as that water is leaking out, so is the trust. So is the power. And it takes a lot longer to patch that up. So you need to maintain that trust. And you need to have a look at, what are the trust default settings in your business? What is the natural mindset? What do people pick up? The second they join your organization, what do they pick up? Are you designing a business for contribution, or are you designing a business for control? Are you designing a business for contribution, or are you designing a business for control in the way that you lead? So, principle number three. It is all about incorruptible leadership. Incorruptible. Leadership needs to show up. Now, for those of you in the room, you can do your own little private internal survey. How is your leadership showing up? Does your leadership, I got a response there. Does your leadership behave the way that your business should be behaving? Do they demonstrate the type of behaviors that are going to take your culture forward? Are your leaders walking the required talk, and are they being held to account? There's a model that talks about exactly how to do that. Because I get so many people saying, but we don't know how. Well, there it is. There it is. It works. And that's come from hundreds of leaders around the world working with it. So if we just loop back a little bit to WTF, what's the future? For me, our biggest challenge is the time zone difference. And somebody said this in a conference I was at the other day. In New York, it's 2:45 p.m., but at our head office, it's 1974. The future is no longer a time frame. The future is a mindset. It's about how we think. The future is all about how we think. And we need to start to become equipped. It's this simple. Life is this simple. When you understand your brain, all you need to have is mindset, ways of thinking, and ways of doing. You need to have a thinking consistency, and you need to have a doing consistency. Do the right, think the right things and do the right things. Know what the right things are. And if you do that, where you land up is as a company behaving awesomely. It's simple maths. It's the right ingredients get us to the right place. Now, to go back to a lot of what Mark and Francois were talking about in terms of getting the right people into your environment, because I believe everything works if the right people do the right things consistently. The employee value life cycle is much like dating. These two are on a, I don't know what number date this is, because she's on her phone. And he's like looking at her like, I want to marry you. They're having slightly different experiences of this dating story. But the life cycle of a human being in a business is much like a romantic relationship. It starts off with the flirting and the lying about how fantastic each one is. And it's usually in the interview process between organization and candidate that the candidate has fabricated their CV, and there's all sorts of fancy stuff going on, and it's a lot of nonsense. And the organization, the person who desperately needs to place somebody in this role, is telling you how fantastic the organization is, even though they've got their own CV on PNET looking for another role. The lying is insane. But there's a cycle that unfolds. And again, it's complicated until you break it down into a method. And the method works very simply. The value proposition, we call it an EVIP, because every human being is a valuable human being, a VIP, very important person. Remember what a CBA is. organization to which the best people want to come, do come, choose to stay, shoot the lights out. So you've got your attract phase, where they want to come. You've got your hire and induct phase, which is usually where the pawpaw hits the fan because whoever's doing it is useless and doesn't realize, sorry if you're doing it, doesn't realize that there's somebody who's trying to make a massive life decision. And instead of you getting the information back to them on time, you're at golf. You know, it's this kind of thing. This is critical. This is where you're showing your true hand. This is the type of organization we are. But it slips there a lot. And then there's obviously onboarding, performing, developing. This is the growth phase and departing. You said people have left and you've given them a hug and said, hey, maybe we'll see you again. That's what you should be doing, is good goodbyes. Because if you get your organization, the experience right, people should never ever want to leave or choose to leave, except if an opportunity comes up somewhere else that you can't compete with. But if it comes up in your organization, they will want to come back because of how amazing it was. That's what you want to get right. So people say, fantastic. How the hell do we do this? I gave it to you. You've got all the experience touch points. All you have to do is have a look at which of these are most critical, need the most investment, most intentionality at that phase of the life cycle, at that phase of the life cycle. They all matter always. Which ones need the most attention? The model and method is there for you. So get stuck in and have a look at what has to happen there. What has to happen over there? Because that is where the relationship starts. That's the honeymoon period. We're working towards engagement and marriage. Then we get to over here, it's separate bedrooms. It's a relationship cycle. But if you want to keep the magic, you have to invest. You have to consider there's another person in this gig. Also, often it falls apart over here in the onboarding phase. I worked with a client recently. They've got offices in 40 countries. And they had a spate of people posting on social media. Imagine how bad it must be. You've just started a new job, and you have no scum to go onto Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn and say, this is what happened to me in my first week of employment. Because they have no intention of staying. And they had a whole bunch of them. Where people would arrive, they weren't in the system, they had no email address, no security card, nobody met them, no laptop, no job description. Or they arrived, one situation, somebody arrived at one of our, I'm not going to mention the organization because I have a contract, but was given, this is a very senior person. This is like EXCO minus one level. Was told that for the first month, this was never mentioned in the interview process, for the first month, she had to watch nearly 80 hours of onboarding videos before she was allowed to be given an email address, a laptop, attend meetings. Can you imagine how this person was feeling? 80 hours. Like, of onboarding, what can you possibly learn? So we've got to be very careful, those of you who are in this space, not to create EAD, employee alignment dysfunction. The story you told is not what you deliver, because that's where you're going to see your struggle around retention. It's not the experience you're creating. So again, it goes back to the experience touch points. I saw this the other day, I thought it was fascinating. We are hiring operational PH CEO. Check this out, this is how you recruit. Following role will apply to male candidates only who possess the following attributes: a very high level of discipline, preferably ex-military or paramilitary. Okay, so how many of you qualify at this stage? Physically fit, 25 to 35 years of age, single, valid heavy duty license, okay, experience and qualifications with emergency services, okay, private security, licensed firearm holder, occupational health, sober habits, good level of street smarts, okay, travel without restrictions, cross-country at short notice, be on standby 24/7, attention to detail, surf proficient. You can phone Tamara if you fit this. You know who they are looking for? James Bond. that's what they are looking for, it's James Bond. So, critical, big words. It's your job, no matter what you're doing in organization, in everything you touch, to be creating the conditions for success. In everything you touch, to be creating the conditions for success. Why would we not? Now, for the HR practitioners in the room. HR, human resources. You saw my Pascal slide about human beings are not a resource, they are the source of everything that an organization does. But we have a very real complexity with the human capability. We have the risk of irrelevance. With everything that's going on, I think that HR is faced with a real conundrum. HR can very much stand for human remains, if we don't get it right. It's the death of the human. That department's going to be interesting. Or HR can stand for human relevance. You choose. So the message in this principle here was think long and hard about people. Think long term about people. And it is your call whether it's going to be human remains or human relevance. You play a part. You play a part. We've all got to show up differently. This is that humans being thing. More so now than ever before. Why does this all matter? What is the relevance of what I'm sharing with you? This guy is lying there, people are just walking past. Why is this employee experience narrative so critical? What we found while we were researching all these organizations is many, in fact, almost all of them were highly, highly innovative. So I went a step further and I had a look at studying the most innovative organizations in the world. What do they all get right? They switch on the human beings. So there's a tension between employee experience and innovation readiness. The more, the higher the experience is, the more innovation ready, innovation fit, because the psychological safety is high. People will think, contribute, and innovate. And that enables you to be relevant into the market. That enables you to adjust, be switched on, tuned in, adjusting to suit. Businesses used to win through amplified efficiency. Efficiency was a huge thing in business. It still matters, but businesses are now winning through amplified learning. Learning is where it's at. We have to be learning. We have to be applying ourselves to constant learning, formal and informal, as Mark said earlier. But we have to be constantly learning. We can't be Rolfing. We can't be Rolfing. So we spend our time putting together tons of different ways for organizations to understand learning context and this human experience. No 2 days are alike because the way we've done things has to change. The way we've done things has to change. You get to the behaviors that you reward. And if you're not rewarding learning, you're not going to get it. I hear too often, I don't have time to read. I don't have 10 minutes to watch a video. Please don't send me stuff. This is my coaching clients. Or people in culture processes. We have to start changing what's important in terms of the way people behave. We have to mandate and measure what matters. What are you measuring? What are you mandating? What are you making important? Are you ignoring the critical stuff? So, you have 5 principles. I could get a sleeping bag, a tent, and food, and I can do this for weeks and weeks and weeks, because there's so much. We are so complex. We are so beautiful as human beings. But I've shared 5 that I think you can work with. There's tools inside each of them. There's methods and models inside each of them. One thing I hate is when authors write books and it tells you what to do, but it doesn't give you a clue how to do it. I try and give you the how. What I've given you here is actually a way of thinking about people that facilitates better decision making. That's what it is. Businesses don't do business with businesses. Not at all. Businesses, people do business with people. People do business with people. Leaders to employees, employees to employees, and employees to customers. People do business with people. I learned something really interesting, just to wind this out. In a coaching session the other day, I was working with the CEO of a fintech, very fast scale-up. And he said to me, I just want that it flows, that we have less of the conflict and less confusion, and just want a culture that works. And I said to him, what does works mean for you? And he said to me, I want less hard moments. I thought this was brilliant. His leadership ethos now is everything you do, all you're thinking about is, am I creating a hard moment for myself or someone else? Make your decisions about, is this thing I'm about to push send, have I just created a hard moment for someone on the other side to understand, to work with it, yes or no? Just focus on less hard moments. And I'm sharing it because it's been percolating in my brain as I think there's something in that. So people say to me, where the hell do we start? And when you're trying to cross a busy rapid, where do you put your feet? You test the rocks, and you put your feet on those that don't wobble. So the things that you know, the things you have certainty about, is where you start. So you start from certainty, you've got to work out what is for sure, and then you maintain flexibility. Start from certainty, maintain flexibility. Now, why am I telling you that? Because what I can guarantee you, because I did the research, is for now, until I have new information, certainty is these experience touch points. If you're trying to build a culture, we know these are the things you have to get right. So don't mess with that. Mess with how you're going to do it. Mess with how you're going to do it. That's the flexibility. But get these right. That's the certainty. How? That's the experimentation. But that's where you start. That's where you start. And it doesn't have to be big, massive, sweeping changes. Everybody here eating sushi? Most people, I'm sure. Most of you fell, I'm sure, for the prank. No, it's just avocado. And you cried through every orifice. Why we call it wasabi changes is very often wasabi, small, subtle little bit of wasabi, significantly changes the experience of the dish. Same with changes in humaning. Small changes, often easier to accept, often easier to work with, can make a huge difference to the experience that somebody is having. Look for the wasabi changes. I want to read you something. Richmar Holland is a friend, he's a friend of Mark's as well, colleague. When we were writing this book, I went to Rich, he's a smart guy, and I said to him, he was writing a column at the time in Longevity magazine, and it was called The Last Word. I said to him, I'd like you, as somebody who's built a great business culture, to write the last word in the book. And Rich wrote this. He said, you know, I've always been opposed to the line, people are our greatest asset. Firstly, because often as it's said, it's really demonstrated. True. Secondly, and more importantly, I just don't think it's true. In the 21 years I've owned Missing Link, the people have almost all changed, but the company and its culture is still here. So your people are not your greatest asset. Your culture is. But your culture is driven and kept alive by the people. So we should probably start acting accordingly. I thought that was brilliant. We should probably start acting accordingly. Thank you, Rich. So, take care of yourselves and take care of each other. Thank you.
Round of applause.
Maybe I'm foolish, maybe I'm blind. Thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm